Good morning. It's good to hear all of the voices. I guess we call that fellowshipping, right? When we're all talking and coming together. You got me thinking about something here. You know, it's great to understand and know that God actually enjoys us. He calls us to assemble. And I want you to consider this. This is the prophet Zephaniah, and speaking with a restored obedient Israel, and we're being obedient right now by coming together and assembling. That's what he calls us to do as brothers and sisters in Christ. So I'm quickly trying to find this verse. Zephaniah 3, it's verse 17. It says, "The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you." Isn't that amazing to think that the God of the universe takes delight in me? I don't get that, but I'm thankful. He will quiet you with his love. And it goes further. He will rejoice over you with singing. Incredible. Thank you for that, Lord. So thank you for assembling and coming together and allowing me to be able to worship with you and the worship team. I'm really thankful for that. This morning, we're going to have you stand up. And let's do this. We haven't done this in a while. I was reminded this morning. Tawny, thank you for this. Yeah, we're going to go around and we're going to do a welcome time. It's not going to be welcome hymn. We'll start playing. And you go around, say hello to somebody, and then be attentive because I'll have you come back, okay? And we'll start worshiping the Lord using our voices. So go ahead and take a moment and go around and greet your brothers and sisters in brotherly love.
Thank you. All right, stand back up. No, I'm just kidding. Sit down. Now, nobody has to do extra exercises today. I'm a new guy here, so maybe if you're worshiping with us and a new guy here, we've got a Connect card in the dealy thingamabobber, you know, the bulletin. I don't know about this church language. I don't have it all down yet, so you'll fit right in. But I'd love to be able to pray for you. Where's Marsh? Marsh gives me one most weeks, and I'm praying for you, Marsh, and your lovely bride. And so we just want to pray for you. We want to be able to connect with you and just see how we might be of service to you. So it's a good help to me. And then I've got a few names to learn, and I'm not very smart, so it just kind of gives me one more thing to connect. So I'd love to see you do that. I also just want to take a minute, church, and just tell you I'm proud of you. I think God's smiling at you. We've got donations out here for Tyler and watching you guys rally around for Rhonda and Curtis. There's also a jug, if you forgot. I got tricked, though. I thought it was going to be Mary. I thought she was bringing me cheese balls. You know, because it's the Super Bowl, and so I thought I was getting, she's coming up with cheese balls, and it was, but she was just showing me that we put out, so she's going to take care of me at the Super Bowl party, I'm sure of it, so don't worry, I'm not even overly a fan of cheese balls, but you know, if you think you're going to get them, and then they're pulled away from you, it's a big deal. So if you were not able to get something to help go shopping, for that family, I sure want to encourage you to love on them and see what God will do. Use what the devil intends for harm to a family to watch God just expose that and let light shine on it and see good come from it. So very exciting. Taking enough of our time with my shenanigans, but we just want you to know you're welcome here. We love you and we're glad that you're here to worship with us today. Father, we thank you. We pray that our worship today will be something that honors you. That as we sing, it won't just be words, but it'll be from the overflow of our heart. God, some of us have come weary and burdened. And we don't have an overflow right now. And so where that's the case, I pray that you will just let them be still. And let the truth as we sing wash over them. That everyone will be refreshed in the goodness that is you, our God. Knowing that you love us exactly the way we are right this moment. But in your mercy and kindness that you love us even more, so you're not going to leave us this way. God, where we have come shackled by sin, that you will free us. Where we've come bound to burdens, that they will be lifted. That we will be encouraged and motivated to live for you, to serve you. Thank you, Lord. We ask you to be blessed this morning, that our worship would honor you. We pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. Would you stand with me? Let's continue to worship our Lord using our voices. Is enough for me.
decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I had decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Here with me, that we get to worship the Almighty God. What a blessing it is. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Well, good morning, church. Did we dismiss Children's Church? Did I miss that? Children's Church is dismissed. The herd that's going.
Pastor reminded me to tell everybody that Children's Church is dismissed.
He's so good. So we're in the book of John, and we're continuing to work through the book of John. I want you to see, as we see this, what is God's message to us? And the word is that our God is the God of everything. Right? And that, honestly, can be kind of hard to see sometimes. Sometimes we feel like things are out of control. I've heard people talk about what's going on with our police department. And, oh, is this terrible? And I have a different take. And I know what's going on even in some of the lives of our church members. I know how terrible, and I have a different take. And what I want you to see is exactly what God is saying in the book of John. He says that he loves us so much and exactly the way we are, but so much that he's not going to leave us this way. And so what he does is, I'm going to say this at least 100 times today, he lets that light penetrate into the darkness, and he exposes the darkness and then eradicates it. Because the darkness, listen, the darkness cannot overcome the light. And when we're the ones that are going through it, it hurts. But on the other side, glorious, and I'm going to point that out to you this morning so that you don't think you're the only one. I just know where God's going this morning, and it's awesome. But in the just little things I want you to just think about, because I want you to just have eyes to see what God is doing in our community. All right? And this is just proof that he'll just use anybody. Because look around. First of all, I don't know if y'all have seen, but this side is way less than this side of the room. So I've started talking to some people maybe about the soap they use or are not using. Y'all remember that when John closed in prayer a few weeks ago when I was sick and he was making fun of me? Well, it's my turn. So he said he was going to get cookies to try to bribe people to sit next to him because he knew nobody wanted to sit. Look at him. He's just literally all by himself. So, but we've been doing Upward at Memorial for 18 years. And as I've been told, never has there been any kind of a recognition or a write-up for Upward in our local paper. And I actually had a conversation, and that was said to me. And within an hour to an hour and a half of that conversation, I get a text message that says the editor of the paper is here and he's taking pictures and he wants to do a write-up on what's going on at Memorial. And then you have our police department. But I want you to understand, you see, the police is the righteous arm of God to bring his justice in our world. But when that justice is corrupt, normally they get away with it. Normally it just keeps happening. But the mercy of our God is he's letting the light come into the darkness and exposing it. And yes, there's going to be turmoil and difficulty in the meantime. But what's coming is his righteousness, and his righteous police force is a blessing from God. You see, it's not, the devil might think he's got something on us. But the light is exposing the darkness, and it's being eradicated. Our God is at work, y'all. I don't know if you know this, but then there was a write-up in the paper for Washington over what y'all did as you joined and prayed for our police department. If you don't think that God is up to something, you don't have eyes to see, and I want to encourage you to pay attention that our God is the God of everything. And so he is, in his mercy, he's working in us. Because some of y'all are messed up. And I know because you asked me to be your pastor, so... All right, so we're in the book of John. I want you to see, I need you to see that our God is the God of everything. There is nothing out of his control, and he is working for his glory and our good. All right, so John the Baptist, as we see this first part, John the Baptist has a job, and John the Baptist gets it because his job is not about making himself a platform. His job is about pointing to the Christ that is coming. And John just does it really well. So he keeps on task. And you can think about that for your own self. How hard is it there to have mission drift? What is it we really are here for? What is it that I do in my day-to-day life? What is my job? And John never loses sight of saying, that's the anointed one of God. That is the Lamb of God. And the light that he brings is going to overcome the darkness. But you know, it doesn't feel like that when we turn on the news. But I also want you to pay attention that the prince of the power of the air who controls those airwaves and those news, he's not going to tell you good things about our God. He's going to tell you despair and destruction and brokenness and hurt. We have the remedy. It is the word of God. So today we're going to see in the ministry of Jesus begin. He's going to start to increase and be the focal point. The baptizer is going to keep pointing to Jesus because that's the call on his life. God has told me to do this, then this is what I will do. I got something else for you. Nope, this is what I'll do. I've got this other opportunity. No, this is what I'll do. Why don't you just build for yourself a following? No, this is what I will do. John stays on point, on message. And even today we're going to see he's going to send those who have been following him to Jesus. And you know, that's not the way of this world. But even there, he has his eye on the prize. And we're going to see what happens when those people who encounter Jesus throw all caution to the wind and let that truth settle in on them, and what a proper response is. And so, as the ministry of the word begins, John chapter 1, verses 35 through 42, we'll see in 35 through 39, a personal introduction, and then 40 through 42, a personal invitation. And so we begin just looking at the word of God. I want you to read with me and see John chapter 1, let's go 35 through 42. The next day, that is, so remember what has happened is we're going to look at the last 2 weeks. You have this first day that those religious elite come out to talk to John and find out why he's doing what he's doing and under what authority is he doing it. And then when they don't get their satisfactory answer, they come out a second day to watch and to examine and to look again. This is now the third day. So now the next day, he saw Jesus coming toward him and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." You know, church people might get excited about that. "This is he whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks before me because he was before me." Oh, I read the wrong passage. And look, y'all just let me go. Y'all are so wonderful. Well, let's just skip down to 35. "The next day, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God.'" Sounds familiar. Yeah, that's a better response. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. And Jesus turned and saw them following him, and he said, "What are you seeking?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come, and you'll see." So they came and saw where he was staying, and he stayed with them that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means the Christ. He brought him to Jesus. And Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John, but you will be called Cephas," which means Peter. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you for the Apostle Peter, this man that we're going to know. Thank you for his impetuousness, his passions, his strengths, all of his weaknesses. And I think we can all find comfort knowing that you called a man like that, so there's hope for us. I thank you for Andrew, who got a glimpse of the truth and would never put it away. I thank you that John was faithful to keep pointing so that we have confidence that your Christ, your Messiah, our Jesus, is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Let us be encouraged to know that you're the God of everything and that you are at work. That our Savior, the Word, the Light, pierces everything in your people so that we can become like Jesus. That your light pierces the darkness so that we're not even alone. That our job to go and tell people that we have found the Messiah would reign in us. God, speak to us and change us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So the next day, as John is standing with the two disciples, the baptizer continues his message. You ever just pay attention? I want you to really just fall in love with reading the scriptures, and I want it to come to life to you. So I want you to think about just three dudes standing, maybe in the parking lot, right? Three guys are standing there, and clearly one of them is the leader in the group. And as Jesus is walking by, and again, John catches a glimpse. "Behold, the Lamb of God." There he is, boys. That's right, that's the one. Somebody's awake. Y'all rest of you take notes. There he is. That's him, boys. Yes. John, in his normal way of speaking, just for the record, there's two disciples. We know Andrew. Who's the other one there? Come on. Extra credit. Who's the other one? It's John, right? The one who never names himself. So John the Baptizer is standing there. Two disciples. One is Andrew. We're going to see him in a minute. Who's the other one? You know the other guy. Behold, that's him. I've been telling you guys this for a while, and I want you to know. And apparently, see, we don't even get all the good insider information, but apparently it's now time for the ministry of Jesus to begin because John isn't making disciples for himself anymore. Now, they're going to hold on, and we're going to see that as we go through the Gospels. We're going to see that even into the book of Acts after Jesus has ascended, that there are those holding on to John. But John is all the time pointing. And John's going to have some trouble too, just for the record. John's not going to grasp everything, and I'll make mention in just a little bit, but John's going to have trouble with this, but he knows his job. And I just love the singular focus, and I wonder what we look like if we could know our singular focus. Why has God placed you in this world, and why does he keep breath in your lungs? To have that singular focus, John says, that's the one. And in this point, from here on, John will begin to decrease in his ministry. John the Baptizer will begin to decrease in his ministry. He's fulfilling his God-given role. He witnessed the verification that Jesus is the Messiah because the Spirit descended on him and remained. And he's able to say, that's the one. And so he has done what God gave him to do. Now, Jesus is walking by, and these two disciples that are John's, this is a beautiful picture because this is, again, not how we do things. We want to build for ourselves kingdoms, right? And we want to go out and see people get saved, but then are they going to come to Memorial? Well, how is our congregation growing? And that's a fine question, but in all honesty, do we care if the kingdom is growing? You see, this is the problem where we get churches, and you know, I'm disgruntled at this church, or you've got a better program at your church, and then we just rearrange deck chairs. We're not doing anything to increase the kingdom. So our focus is to go after those who are not in a church, those who do not know God as a personal Lord and Savior, and then make them sit by John. They won't even know any difference. They'll just assume everybody at church smells like that, and they'll be like, okay. I mean, good, right? He smells like cookies. At least he will next week. But we tend to want to build for ourselves a kingdom. And we want to build for ourselves a following. We want to feel good as we walk down. And I think the way of doing things in this world is like when you watch birds fly in the V formation. And you've got the guy who's a leader, and here's all of his gang behind him. Oh, that's somebody. Look at how many people follow him. And when you go to conventions, I mean, think about when you see a celebrity and all the entourage that are just following behind them. How often do you see celebrities go, no, please stop that. There are better things for you to put your attention on. Right? That's what they're wanting. John already has achieved this. John's got these people right here, and specifically these two. And I got to tell you, these two must be something because Jesus picks them. Right? I mean, clearly they're not, but there's something about them. And what is it? Their hearts are inclined to the things of God. And so he says, yeah. And what I will make mention as we move on is John again says, behold, the Lamb of God, is that he is pointing to a future that has not yet happened. That is going to be the Lamb of God, but he is not now, but he knows something. And this is a really big deal here because God has given John what he doesn't usually give us. God does not tell us the end from the beginning almost ever. Mostly how God is going to deal with you and with me is he's going to, like he did with Abram, and he's going to say, I want you to follow me. You said, where am I going? He says, I'll show you when we get there. And he goes, oh, okay. But what we tend to want to look for is God, all right, I'm willing to do this. I'm going to step out. I'm hearing what you're saying. But how's it going to go? What's it going to look? Tell me it's going to be okay. Can you imagine? Just get in your mind's eye as God's giving a dream to a young man. Imagine if God went to Joseph and said, hey, buddy, I'm going to use you. I'm going to pick you for a very special mission. But I'm going to make you, your brothers hate you and want to kill you. Sign me up. But wait, there's more. I'm going to have him sell you as a slave. Sign up. Oh, but wait, there's more. I'm going to have someone come after you. And you're going to have the opportunity. Are you going to stay righteous and connected to me, or are you going to go after the way of the world? Oh, I'm going to stand righteous for you. Well, good. I'm glad you said that because there's more. I'm going to throw you in jail. But in the end, after about 12 to 14 years of this kind of treatment, you're going to get to save your whole family. Sign me up. Like maybe the last part, but if you knew all that God was going to take you through in order to use you, would you say yes? You see, God doesn't generally tell us the end from the beginning. He says, will you follow me? It's going to hurt. And there's going to be missteps because we live in a world that is fallen and broken, in a world that has attacked our Savior and will absolutely attack us. So God does not give the baptizer, God does give the baptizer the end from the beginning. He says, that is the Lamb of God. Why is that important? Because it's the imagery that Jesus is going to be the sacrifice that saves God's people from sin and death. You see, He is the Lamb, the Passover Lamb, the blood on the doorpost, that those who faith in Christ and apply the blood, their sins are forgiven, and they get. But wait, there's more. Do you all know what you get? Do you know the whole point of chasing after Jesus is not His stuff? You get Him. You get the God of all creation as your prize. So that's the problem with being religious. Is that you don't want the prize, you want the stuff that the prize has. And so our question that we want to wrestle with is, at the end of your life, when you have lost all dignity, and you've lost all of your stuff, and no one cares about you or comes to see you, and you're broken and riddled, and you have nothing left in this world, and I can come to you and say, is Jesus enough? And you say, that's all I need. But what ends up happening is that the stuff matters more than the Savior. John is getting a glimpse of the end. This Savior will take away the sin of the world, and so all who will draw near to Jesus will gain Him as reward. Do you want Him? Do you know Him as your Lord and Savior? And so as John says, behold the Lamb of God, and we know this is the one that takes away the sin of the world. He says this to His two disciples. And He says, I want you to pay special attention. Go and follow that one. And then these two, I kind of think I see why John didn't like to name himself in a lot of cases, because you know he's gonna. Here's one that I don't think is overly exciting. And I think the interesting thing is Jesus turns to them and they're following Him. And I want to see with my mind's eye. I really do want a time machine at some point. I just want to go back and see things. I don't want to interact or change anything, but just really see things. And so you have these two guys. Can you imagine like little children, you know, as they're following behind, they're wanting to see, right? They want to experience, but they're not sure if they're going to get in trouble. They're not sure what's happening. And so they're following at a distance and like, come on. He went down that way. And at some point, Jesus turns around and He says, what are you guys looking for? And this is a natural interaction Jesus is going to have this all throughout the Scriptures. You pay attention. We mess this up. In our earthly way of dealing with things, we are sure we know what people need and what they're doing. We're sure we have the answer. Right, and so we see. So you see someone who's blind, and you're like, "Well, how can I help you?" Well, if you have the power, you're like, "Well, hey, come here, blind guy. I'm going to fix you." But you know, when Jesus encounters blind people, what does He do? What can I do for you? But my thought is, blind. I want you to fix me. But you see, almost never is that thing the problem. See, the blind guy's problem wasn't that he was blind. The blind guy's problem is he didn't know Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Because Jesus will even tell you, if your eye's offending, you pluck it out. Being blind, that's not eternity's waiting. Eyes will come back. Being on a cane is not the problem. There's a day coming with a glorified body where you will leap and dance before the Lord. But knowing Jesus is a big deal. And so Jesus turns and He says to these guys, well, what are you seeking? Why are you really here? Is this idle curiosity or is there real desire? Do you have a demonstration of faith that you are chasing after? Or are you just here like those who will I mean, some 13,000-14,000 that are going to watch Jesus feed 5,000 men only. Like, why are you here? Because he didn't have that following, right? Only a few hundred are following Jesus at that point in his ministry. Why, what, gentlemen, why have you left John to come to me? Why, church, are you here? What is it that you are looking for? What is it that you want? And so while it seems obvious to us, it clearly our Savior would have had to know the real answer, but what is God able to do for you? And their answer is just not very specific. Again, in my mind's eye, you see a young man wanting to talk to a young girl for the first time, right? And the hands get sweaty, and you're not sure. And, you know, well, what am I going to... Hi. Right? And then you walk, and you're like, oh, you idiot. I want to... You know, hear something really profound and dramatic, like, well, we're seeking the Messiah. Are you him? Right? That would make sense, right? That's a good question. Do you agree? And yet, again, young man talking to a young woman for the first time, where do you live? Where are you going today? Who cares where you're going today? But see, what's the heart of what they're asking? Like, they call him rabbi. We recognize that you're a teacher. We recognize you have authority. We recognize that you're somebody we're supposed to listen to. We've examined you, and we've looked closely, and you are who we should be listening to. Rabbi. Which means teacher. But maybe you're too busy. Maybe you've got other things going on and we just really don't rate. Church people? How many of you don't ask for things in prayer because God's too busy? It's not that, but here, see, we're very pious, right? It's like there are people with real needs. There's a lot of stuff going on. We don't need to worry about my simple request. As if God doesn't have enough time, right? Teacher, maybe we could come hang out with you sometime. You just let us know where you're staying. Tell us when it's a good time to come visit you. We don't want to presume anything. And instead, you have the Savior says, come on, I'll show you. We got plenty of time for you. You're welcome. Come press in. And he's going to invite them to be a part of his life, to walk and talk and to taste and see that the Lord is good. And so this personal introduction that happens from the baptizer just changed two men's lives and their eternities. So then what's the response? I wonder if this could happen today. I wonder if this is just something that happens as he's calling disciples or if God's showing us something as a pattern. And so looking 40 to 42, you see this personal invitation. It says, one of the two heard John the Baptizer that was speaking. His name was Andrew. And now that Andrew is Simon Peter's brother. And he first found his own brother Simon. And he said to him, we have found the Messiah. We've heard this our whole lives, so that's not a big deal. But this is a huge deal. And to say this out loud is earth-shattering, life-changing. Wait, what? And I think the neat part, there's I really like watching human interactions, and God has stirred the Apostle John, the author of this book, as he's making mention of, you know, things that we're not seeing in the other Gospels. But he's going to stir the Apostle John in this to tell us about Andrew. And Andrew's going to have a main theme throughout the book of John. And it's going to go something like this. Andrew encounters Jesus. He knows that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Andrew knows that his life is forever changed. And he's just going to start telling people about it. And the first one that he's going to go to is his brother. And he's going to say, "Dude, come and see. I know this is crazy. I know that we've been talking about this for 1,000, 2,000 years, expecting that Jesus is going to come, this Messiah is going to come. We finally found the anointed one of God. And what you should really expect, but because we've heard this so much, what you should really expect is this should not come from a fisherman. Right? This should be coming from somebody important. But I want you to, you'll hear me talk about this all the time. God never, ever works that way. You know how his birth was announced? To whom? To shepherds. See, shepherds were so lowly and thought so little of, a shepherd was not even legally allowed to give testimony in the court of law. So if you are on trial and you say, "Oh yeah, here's a shepherd witnessed the whole thing," he doesn't even get to testify. Shepherds are clearly not trustworthy. God says, "No, I'm going to announce it through a shepherd." Now, who's the first person to see to know that the Christ has risen from the tomb? A woman. Women are so lowly and thought so little of, they are not even legally allowed to give testimony in a court of law. See, he's always using what confounds this world to demonstrate that he's the God of everything and everyone. Now he's going to begin his ministry, and he's going to use fishermen. John, you know what they smell like. It's the gift that keeps on giving, I will tell you what. Right? They smell like fish, right? And so nobody wants to sit around them. I'm going to have to repent. This is terrible. And he's using that which doesn't make sense to the world. And I love this because that's me. I'm telling you this with as much truth and candor as I can. I would never choose me. I wouldn't choose me for salvation. I know what I've done. I know what I've thought. I would never choose me. I certainly would never choose me to tell other people about the God of all creation. And I mean that with all truth. And I absolutely would never choose me to stand on a platform to tell other people about him. I tell him all the time he's wrong. Pick someone else. Pick someone better who loves you better, who's more devoted to you. And he picks fishermen. And he picks people who can't even give testimony in the court of law. He picked you because you're worthless, but in his eyes, you're priceless. You are everything. Man, if that doesn't just shock you, I don't know if a defibrillator will help, but you might not truly be alive. He loves you. Exactly the way you are. Andrew, John is going to point out, the Apostle John is going to point out in his gospel, every time he mentions Andrew in his gospel, he's going to tell you that Andrew is bringing people to Jesus. Every single time. And this is unique to John's gospel, but it's going to happen in here, in chapter 2. It's going to happen in chapter 6, verse 8. And it's going to happen in chapter 12, verse 22. And so as I even made mention to the feeding of the 5,000 men that happens in chapter 6, it's Andrew that brings the little boy. Right? They're like, what do we got to feed all these people? And Andrew says, well, Jesus, this little boy has this. What can you do with it? And when the Greeks are wanting to find out about the Messiah, it's Andrew that's going to bring the answers to them. And you don't want to over-spiritualize things, right? We don't want to maybe learn anything out of this. But you almost get the idea that whenever Andrew encounters a life occurrence, that his answer is, let's get to the Savior. Let's go to the Christ and see what He will do. How is He going to change your life? How is He going to fix your situation? How is He going to be the answer to what you need right now? Andrew always gets it. He's always pointing. Now, his brother, on the other hand, makes me feel all right. I love the Apostle Peter. But Andrew's response to every problem is to constantly keep pressing into the relationship that he has with Jesus and looking for Jesus to be the solution. And he says, Peter, bro, we found the Messiah. Come and see. And then Jesus looks at him when he finally gets there. And the first record, the only thing that we get to hear from John, and remember, these guys are partners, just for the record. They're fishing partners. The Apostle John and the Apostle Peter are fishing buddies. They have a business. Dos Bros Fishing. And John's going to write the first interaction because he's there. Says the first thing that Jesus says to Peter is, you're going to be called Cephas. And again, we're just so used to reading the scriptures that means rock. It means stone. We know that Peter's the rock and the stone. But when you're so used to the scriptures that you forget to just kind of dive in, and this is why I'm so thankful for the Apostle Peter, is this is another indication, just like the baptizer, when he says, the Lamb of God, it's the end from the beginning. Jesus just told us the end from the beginning of the Apostle Peter, because this is not who Peter is. Peter is emotional. He is passionate. He is a speak and act first and don't. This is the man. It's a man who sees Jesus walking on the water. This is a fisher man. He knows what happens if you get on water. But he sees Jesus on the water, and so his reaction is, well, if my Savior can do it, I can do it. What happens when he takes his eyes off the Savior? Boom. Thank God for the Apostle Peter. But wait, there's more. This is the guy who will stand in front of his Savior after they come down from the Mount of Transfiguration, and Jesus says, I'm about to go to Jerusalem so that I can be sacrificed for the sin of the world. And Peter jumps up and says, I'll never let that happen. And then words that will haunt Peter the entire rest of his earthly life, get thee behind me, Satan. You do not have your mind on the things of God. You're thinking about your own self, and that's the wrong place to have your attention. Or how about this guy in the garden when they come to arrest Jesus that pulls out a sword and cuts a guy's ear off? Thank God for the Apostle Peter. This is the same guy in the garden when they're praying as he comes and he says, seriously, dude, you can't even stay awake for just a little while and pray for me? I've already told you what's coming. Thank God for the Apostle Peter. And this is the same guy. This is the same guy that's going to say, I don't even know that man. I thank God for the Apostle Peter. See, Jesus shows us something here when the first words out of his mouth that are recorded from John is, you're not that man anymore. But you're not that man yet. See, he knows what he's going to take him through. He knows that you're going to become the rock of stability for the church. But this passionate man, this man that often thinks after he acts, that thinks after he speaks, that keeps messing things up, God says, yeah, I'm going to use him. So when I say, hey, ministry opportunity, you go, oh, no, there's somebody better qualified than me. Probably is. God didn't choose those people. God chooses the people who can't do it so that they can't do it. God wants to take those of us who will say yes to him, and he empowers us to accomplish the ministry that he wants to accomplish, and in a way that only he can accomplish it, so that who gets the credit? He does. It's not about us. And we see that from John. Quit trying to make it about your own blessings, he says. I'm gonna take you to a place where you can't do it so that you can't do it. And I want you to hear screamed loudly into your heart. Just maybe close your eyes and let this wash over you. Jesus sees in you what you will be, not what you are. He loves you exactly where you are right now. But he loves you so much that he's not going to leave you this way. And what he's going to do is in his power and might, and this is why you can never try harder to be more holy. This is why you have to press into the relationship, because he's going to do the work through you of transforming your life so that you are transformed from one degree of glory to the next into the image of the one that saved you. But like the Apostle Peter, who was just a fisherman at the beginning, he had a long row to hoe, and there was a lot of polishing that was going to happen. Sometimes God's going to have to take off big chunks. And then sometimes he's going to get out a little file and do a little refining. And then sometimes when you're polishing, he's got just a little blanket that he uses, and it just rubs off just a little bit, enough so that it shines. So in different areas of our life, he's always doing those different things. And the longer you walk with the Lord, the less you see the big hunks getting chopped off. And the more you see the smaller refining. But regardless of your age, when it comes to there's this part right here that doesn't fit, that's not a part of the picture of what he is making, and he knocks off a big chunk, it hurts. I mean, at the point of the Apostle Peter having walked and interacted and seen the most intimate of things, Peter was on top of a mountain. I didn't even bring this one up. Peter's on top of a mountain, and he sees Jesus and Moses and Elijah, and he says, okay, what would you do? But Peter decides, I got something to say. He says, hey, God, hear me out. I got a great idea. What if I just go ahead over here and I'm going to build us some houses? We just live here forever. And then God, in his very kind word, says, hey, Peter, you have no idea what you're talking about. Now, when God talks to me that way, he says, shut up. But the very loving part is he just says, shh. I mean, just think about that. Just presume for a minute that you can go into this hadn't happened, right? The curtain has not been rent. It hasn't split where you can go into the Holy of Holies and have the conversation. And Peter decides, hey, God, I've been thinking. I got a really good idea. This guy. Y'all go back and look. Just look at who you are. Because more often than not, we're the Apostle Peter, and God loves you. He says, come on, keep running with me. I'll take care of knocking off the big chunks. I'll take care of filing. I'll take care of polishing. All you have to do is just keep pressing in like Andrew. And so, as I close today, I want you to think about this. Jesus asked these two disciples a very important and a very compelling question. Why are you here? What is it that you're looking for? And Jesus invited them to join him. Come and follow me. Draw near. If you want to be religious, go be religious. But if you want Jesus, press in. And if you hear him calling you today, I don't have that relationship with him. I want you to hear the very specific invitation that he is saying, come to me, all you who are weak and heavy laden, and he will give you rest for your soul. What does it take? It takes surrendering your life. You see, he's offering you a contract. I will put myself in your place, and you will give me your life in its place. And I will direct you where you go. I will tell you what you are to do. And your simple response is trust and obey. And what do you get for this transaction? The God of all creation. And he takes your punishment and your sin upon himself, and he gives you eternal life in Christ Jesus. He gives you the gift of the Holy Spirit to come and live within you that shows you how to do what it is that he's calling you to do, to give you peace in the storm. And so I invite you to ask him to forgive you of your sins and to be the boss of your life. And he is faithful and just that he will cleanse you of your sin and forgive you of all unrighteousness. And then for those of us who follow Christ, just like Peter, we are to be reminded that it's not that we have ever deserved Christ, but he has freely given himself for us. And what we are now, it's not who we are in Christ. It's who he will make us to be as we press into the relationship. Sometimes we get stuck on the right now. And I'll share with you, I just love the illustration of the needle point, because on the front side it says home sweet home, right? In the back side it's a garbled mess that you can't even tell what it is. And that home sweet home side, that's the not yet. That's the saint that's being perfected in us. But the problem with the backside is that's the sinner that, if you are Christ, has been put to death but still lives within us. And so if you stare at that backside too long, you're going to think that God wouldn't use you. But if you stare at the front side too long, you start to think that you're something that you're not. And so the healthy part of where we are right now is to just keep looking back and forth. Sinner, saint, dying, coming to life. And that's clearly an oversimplification, but that's the healthy balance that we need to have. And so what does God do? He lets the light shine in the darkness, and we've already been seeing that for weeks now. Because in his loving kindness and mercy, he lets that light penetrate those dark areas and blows them up. And at the end, you look more like Jesus, and that is all of our goal. The problem with us is that we're Americans, and we've been told not to hurt. And we've been told not to go through difficulties or trials or tribulations or troubles. But God's going to take you through them. But as we go back to the old footprints poem, right? He's the one walking you through them. You're not ever getting through on your own. And finally, I want you to see, as we learn this lesson from Andrew, what it means to enjoy God as he knew him for who he is and what he did in his life. And the response is, he's just going to go tell everybody about him. So everyone Andrew encounters, he says, hey, I found the Messiah. Come and see. Ms. Kayla got a slide for us. I want you to see this. I want you to see how most people come to faith in Christ. And I wonder if you just looked at that for just 10 seconds. What do you reckon jumps off of that screen? So most religious people say that the job of growing the church is the pastor, right? That's what we pay him for. But the problem with this slide is that this says that the most effective way for people coming to know the Lord is because of us. And what I will call the sphere of influence, you have people around you that God has put a sphere around you, just like John the Baptizer, that you get to influence. And your sphere of influence is not my sphere of influence. And so when we go out and share the gospel and you see somebody with blue hair and gauges in their ears and tattoos, and then because we're good church people and we say, oh yeah, we want to see them get saved, and they get saved and then we welcome them in, and then we work really hard to get them to look like us. Well, we'll teach them to dress later. But that's not how Corinthians tells us. He says, how you were called, remain. Why? Because God's going to use you in your sphere of influence to reach people that I can't reach. You in your sphere of influence to reach people that I can't reach. You in your sphere of influence to reach those I can't reach. You can't reach theirs. They can't reach yours. You are unique, and God has called you to reach your sphere of influence. I didn't make it up. I wish I would have, because that's smart. That's the numbers. And it says if you will fall in love with Jesus, and if you will see all of the relationship that you have is glorious, and then if you will tell people about the relationship that you have found in Jesus, it says people will respond. I have another book that says that 80% of all the unchurched, they went and did a survey on all the unchurched, and they said 80% of the people said we would have come sooner if somebody simply would have asked us. But the problem is, and this is why I want to have people coming up here like Carrie and giving testimonies. By the way, it was Mark, right? At Upward, you had a conversation? Wasn't it Mark? Yeah, he's deer in the headlights. He didn't want me to bring him up here. I won't bring you up here. Mark, sitting in the stands at Upwards again, another gospel conversation that gets started. Just being there. God brings a sphere around you. And again, I will tell you, I believe every one of you that knows the Lord Jesus Christ, if somebody walks up and says, hey, tell me about this Jesus, giddy up. But if I tell you, go talk to that person, you're going to look at me like Mark just did. But in your sphere of influence, you have the ability to talk, right? And you have a comfortability. So God will say, I've called you just the way you are. And so church, I'm going to give you opportunity next week. I've got several things. I don't even know how we're going to work it out. We're going to be here for several hours. Bring your friends. But I'm going to lay before you opportunity for you to reach out to people who don't have a church home and maybe are not even saved, with the invitation that Jesus loves them and for them to press in. I'm going to give you several opportunities and techniques to walk out of here with something tangible to do on your own as the Lord stirs your heart. But what if God used people just like you to reach people just like you? It's an interesting thought, isn't it? Father in heaven, I don't know why you'd use me. I've told you for almost 30 years you made a mistake. And I know there's so many people here that think the same thing. But you do use us. And I've wondered for 30 years why you would die for me. And there's a lot of people in here who don't think that's true. Why would you die for them? There's a lot of people in here who think, I've done too much wickedness for God to ever forgive me. And that's not true. Think of how John even indicated that you're the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. So that all that has happened in the past, all that's where we are now, and all that's coming in the future, that sin has been eradicated. So our part is to press into the relationship. And I thank you for the Apostle Peter. Because though he was saved in Christ Jesus and knew that you were the Savior, he still messed it up. Oh, and God, he messed it up so big. You never threw him away. You continued to restore him at every turn because you knew the man you were making in him, not the man that he was then. And that gives us hope. Because you are an unchanging God. And if your character and nature is to restore those you've called, then we know that you will restore us. Father, I pray that you don't let us respond by just standing and singing because that's what we do. Let us respond out of the overflow of our heart from the depths of us. God, for those who just need to fall at your feet, that they'd even come and kneel at the altar and just cry out to you. We know there's no real altar, but the steps being indicative. And God, we don't care what any man thinks. We care what you think. God, there's people that need to trust you as Lord and Savior. Will you let today be their day of salvation? They may not even be strong enough on their own. Like Andrew did in bringing Peter to you, the Christ. Maybe somebody sitting around can walk them up here so that they can tell the world that they want Jesus to forgive them of their sins and be their Lord and Savior. So that the church can help them to grow and encourage them. God, maybe you're going to call out some people today that say, I want to serve the Lord full time in missions as a pastor. Whatever you're doing, will you give us the strength to trust and obey? And where we're not able to stand on our own, that we can lean on our neighbor. That we might all look like Jesus. We ask you to bless us so that we can bless your name. We ask it in the name of our Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. Amen.
Amen.
As you lead us, don't stand until you're ready to stand. And when you're ready to stand, you sing to the Lord. But if you need to sit there and do business with God, do that. If you need to come up here and pray, you do that. Don't let this be church service. Let's worship. And you can lead us in singing as long as the Lord gives you. You just leave whenever you need to, but you just keep leading us. And we'll see what the Lord will do. If you need to come talk to me, you want to make a decision for the Lord and you want to be held accountable to that, I'll be standing up here. You respond as the Spirit would lead you.